Hey, welcome to our monthly deliverance training class. How'd it go? Thank you, buddy, for doing that. We're getting a lot of sick people coming here for healing, so we need somebody to increase prayer time. If you increase your prayer time, you know what you get? This. I have this little book out in the lobby. I put in all the miracles that I can document medically. Because if somebody gets healed, I always ask them to go to the doctor and get me a report. I don't like to just take somebody's word for it. Because sometimes some people want to be a people pleaser. And if you pray for a people pleaser, they're liable to say, well, yeah, I feel better. And I don't want any of that crap. I just want the real deal. That's it. Well, here's one. Got a new one in. I marked out the patient's name. It's in the book out there. Healed of herpes. Remember when you got herpes? Oh, man, I do. It was in 1983. And that's when AIDS was... And I thought, oh, my God, I got AIDS. I'm dying. I was scared. I didn't know what it was. So I went into the doctor and said, hey, I'm in deep trouble here. I think I got AIDS. He said, well, run some tests on you. And he comes back and he says, Mike, I got some bad news for you. You got herpes, man. I said, what? Herpes? Yeah. Herpes. I'm running around the doctor's office. I've got herpes. Couldn't believe it. Went to happy hour that night, partying. Told all my friends about it. Come rejoice with me. I got herpes. Couldn't believe the good news. I had a friend of mine, years ago I used to be in the prison ministry. So I would travel all around the state to these different prisons. And then I used to have an email blog of what was going on in the prisons. Wild things happening. Well, a guy out in Surprise who was a millionaire, and he was a extremely intelligent man. He practiced international law. And he was retired and went into writing Christian books. He got a hold of one of my emails and wanted to meet me. So he took me to dinner out in Surprise one night. And I became friends with him. And the guy got sick. And nobody even called me. Nobody even called me to let me know, hey, can you pray for Bernie? Nothing. And the guy dies on me. I don't know anything about it. Well, his first wife died on him. They never called me on that one either. His second wife did call, finally, and said, you want to have all of his books? I said, yeah, he already gave me some. For the bookstore. His name is Bernie Korselman. You know, he writes books on salvation, discipleship, stuff like that. He's not a deliverance or Pentecostal guy, but he's got a lot of good material. I said, yeah, I'll take the books, absolutely. The problem is there's so many boxes that my pickup is going to be like 10 trips. So if anybody has a pickup or something, they could help me out Thursday to haul these boxes of books out of his garage. She's given me everything I want. And when people give me everything I want, those are the kind of people I like. All right. Now, just briefly on this. In the secular world, one of these therapies in counseling and psychology and psychiatry is what? Guided imagery. Okay? And it's usually used for people that have anxiety disorders. And the therapist teaches you to go through, I wrote, kind of give you a list there, of step-by-step guide to relieving your anxiety by using your mind, your five senses, and your body to, you know, calm down. It's also used for depression and other illnesses. Here it is. And so, anything that the devil does, he always transitions it into the church. So, tarot cards came out centuries ago. Now we have Christian discernment cards. So you plop that down, pray over that. Plop. Oh, these cards, these have lined up. God wants you to do that. Okay, so the devil always replicates stuff, and then he tries to filter it in. And that's what he's doing here. He's using this. I went over this a couple months ago. Sozo, for example, out of Bethel is one of these. So the guided imagery in secular world transitioned over to now the Christian world. And now people are, you have to believe in the technique there. You got to get comfortable and relax. Okay, nothing wrong with that. Practice deep breathing. Okay. Vividly visualize a scene in your mind. Close your eyes, relax. Involve your senses. See that? Relax. Use your mind. You're not sick anymore. You don't have cancer. You see yourself. You're well. You're running in a field. They also have guided music imagery. Go through your guided imagery, hearing soothing music. See yourself on the beach. See yourself. So the devil then took this and transitioned over here to Christianity. And now people are relaxing, visualizing Jesus visiting them, sitting on their lap, them sitting on his lap, bowling for dollars, traveling on the beach, Jesus holding your hand. Look at, relax, use your senses, feel it. What happens next? He comes to visit you. Then the therapist asks you, what did he say to you? Oh, he told me he loves me. He wants to be with me. Wow, that sounds great. So the demons just simply repackage it, put it in a different Christmas bag, bringing it out at Christmas on a different year. But it's essentially the same thing. Just listen to him. He'll talk to you. Play this music. Follow the rhythm. What's he doing now? Oh, he's standing there in his robe. What's he wearing? Sandals. Yeah, long hair. That's Jesus, all right. Yeah, just like the one I saw in the picture. All the pictures of Jesus are all fake. He doesn't look like any of those pictures. People made it up with some help. I wonder who helped him. Wow. Let me take a wild guess. Satan? Oh, Brother Mike's an actor on Saturday Night Live. I think it's Satan. Okay. No. If you want to hear God speak to you, you can go to Matthew. Mark, Luke, and John. He'll speak right to you. Clear as anything you've ever read. You want to hear God speak to you. Oh, but I want to chit chat with him. Hey, Einstein, everybody wants to chit-chat with him. Okay, it's not time for chitting-chatting. Okay, in glory, you'll see him personally. You'll see everything there. You'll know everything. You'll be known as you're known, Paul said. But now we walk by faith, not by sight. What's going to happen? Well, the same thing that happens here. These images actually pop into their mind. Spirits create images. They do it very easily. They do it in dreams, nightmares, anything. They can do anything. And God won't do that because he knows they'll replicate it. If they see the Holy Ghost do something, they'll pattern it. Because they know that the Christians will fall for it. You're not going to see Jesus. It's the last time you're coming to this teaching, aren't you? Okay, well, this will be your last time, then that's the last time I see you, but he's not going to come visit you. Does it happen on rare occasions? Yes. He came to Paul. Paul saw him personally. Okay. I'm not trying to give you a Debbie Downer, but you ain't Paul. Well, Elijah called down fire from heaven. Okay, sure he did. You're not Elijah. If something happened in the Bible, it doesn't mean it's routinely happening. Okay? I live on a lake in Sun City. It has never parted. But the Red Sea parted. Why can't I part my leg? Maybe I need some guided imagery. Lake part. Lake part. Stupid. Now, the lake I live on is over 50 years old. And it started leaking. And $5 million later, the construction crew that came in to fix the lake, 18 months, it was drained. They drained it, but it never parted. There's a difference between draining and parting. Hello? Yeah, do I believe God can part the Red Sea? 100%, I believe that. Is he going to do that for you? I need more proof. So the point is, just because it's in the Bible doesn't mean that's a routine replication. You're beginning to see why not too many people show up at these Saturday things, but prophetics and charismatics love resurrections. I mean, they love it. And they're always talking about somebody raised from the dead. It's on YouTube, on Christian TV. None of these people ever show up on the TV show. Nobody ever shows up with a book. Yeah, here's Harry Williams. He was dead. Here's the medical reports. DOA, right there. There's the emergency report. Nobody has that. Yep, notice that? Everybody talks about resurrections. Okay, stop it. Stop it. If it's a resurrection or a healing, you can prove it. See these? I got these medical reports on these healings. I asked for them. Right? Because I don't want to just take somebody's word for it. You know? I mean, it's not that I don't believe them. It's just that if you want proof, I want to have some. If you got healed of torn meniscus, well, that's, you could go to a doctor and discover, hey, this torn meniscus healed. Look, there's the report. Patient came in, torn meniscus, claims he was, I'll take that, and I'll put it in my book. There's the book. See this book? This is a book completely foreign to TV preachers. They don't have a book. What I'm about to tell you is going to blow your mind. They asked Benny Hinn for this book. Benny Hinn. No book. He had no book. That's inconceivable to me. I can't believe it. Benny Hinn doesn't have a book this wide of document. Are you kidding me? Sun Sing Wong. And of course, the media made nothing but fun of the guy, mocking him. They hate his guts. The problem was the comb over. That it's not going to go over in the media, but look, you're claiming hundreds of thousands of healings, right? Yeah. Do you have one medical report of a healing? I mean, I'm not doubting he has them. I'm just saying, what are you thinking about? Who's running that? Where's your intelligence? What happened to your common sense? You know the media is going to question you. They're going to criticize you. They're coming after you. They don't like him anyway. They can't stand the guy. So you would just simply have, look at my kidneys. I'm completely healed. You get a report. Your associates do it. Benny doesn't do it. He just tells somebody to go do it. Get a medical report from Sister Sally in Tulsa. She claimed her foot grew back. Okay, well, there'll be a medical report on a foot that grows back, right? Am I the only person that thinks like this? You know, well, where is common sense at? Well, I don't know where it's at, Mike. I'm not sure. Well, I am. You should have had a book this big to show the crooked media that they're criticizing you and they're lying about you. You should have had that. Right? I mean, I would have done it that way. Wow, enormously sad. All right. Any questions on guided imagery? Well, Mike, don't people sometimes have godly dreams? Yes, they do. So don't they sometimes have vision? Yes, they do. Not very often. Okay. Doesn't happen often. Okay. Yeah. Yeah, what he just mentioned was implanted memories. See, and that happens all the time with demons. They put in fake memories of somebody molesting you or something happening in your past that never happened. Why is that? To cause anxiety and stress now over a fake incident in your past. And that's not to say that there aren't real incidences. Of course not. But anything that God does, he copies it. That's the job.
The church doesn't recognize how dangerous this is. Why don't they recognize it?
Demonic delusions. Many of these people that have this guided imagery thing all have all kinds of spiritual problems pop up very shortly thereafter. Weird dreams, odd stuff going on, strange emotions. Then they come back, hey, I'm not feeling well, I don't like, and then the person usually abandons them. Oops, that one didn't work. This isn't a pot shot thing. You know, if something doesn't work, there's a reason it doesn't work. And your job as a minister is to help them figure out why it's not working. What are you doing wrong? What are they doing wrong? Somebody needs to troubleshoot this. You can't just walk out with nothing. All right, now the people you're going to get in your ministry are mentioned in the Bible. but they're mentioned kind of differently. So I pull them out of the Bible and use them as current events. Here is Paul's analysis of humanity before Noah. And he's describing humans. And humans don't change. So I just take the previous civilization, move it forward, and it's like yesterday's newspaper. The Bible is on the money, past, present, and future. Right, here it is. And on these stages of apostasy, these are the kind of people you're going to be running into, sitting in your office that you're going to be having to pray for. They became unthankful, Paul said. Wow, no kidding. Unthankful Christians are as common as seeds. Seeds. What happens there? Well, the devil takes the person's mind, and if God does 10 things for him in the past, the current stress and the current attack causes the person to black out the last 5 times he come through for him. Happens all the time. What I do during the interview is I make little notes about how God helped them in the past. I write them down. They don't know I'm writing them down. I'm tricking them. And then at the end, I start going over their unbelief and their doubt, and I go, what are you doing? What do you mean you unbelieve? You just told me when you were 8, the car swerved that way, and the person grabbed you. Do you remember that? Yeah. Well, who do you think swerved that and grabbed you? You just told me right here that your kidneys got better when you're in the emergency room. Remember that? You told me that story? Yeah. Okay. Doesn't that prove that God's helping you? That he's been watching you even when you were in sin? We were loved even when we were sinners and we were against God. We were antichrist. He still loved us. Doesn't that prove it? And I make a note of it and I show him. Look, this is what you told me. And he's not going to help you now? Really? I don't think so. I think he's going to come through again. So you use the words out of their own mouths. I should have got shot. I couldn't believe it. The bullet went boom and hit that. What do you think did that? What's wrong with you? Somebody's been watching out for you when you were living in hardcore sin. Now, does that happen to everybody? No. Of course, some people die and go to hell, obviously, but it wasn't you. And they're unthankful, number 2. That's what Paul said. They're vain in their imaginations. I just went over it. Use your imagination. There's Jesus. There's an angel. Angels are big. They love seeing angels. What kind of angels do they see? Well, it depends on the type of person. Like, you know, a divorced female will typically see a warrior angel. Male. A lonely guy typically prays and sees a hot babe angel. Whoa. She's a looker. Come on. Number 3, vain imaginations. Now I'm seeing angels. They became dark in their hearts. You'll be counseling people constantly who've lost their faith and gone back to the dark side. Now these are people, remember, lived 6,000 years ago here. 5,000 years, whatever it was. I don't know when it was, but I don't care. It's approximate, thereabouts, whatever. Thousands of years ago. That's what these people were like. They thought they were wise. Oh my goodness. How many times have you somebody come to you for prayer and then start telling you how to pray? Wait a minute, you're the sick one. You came to me. Well, this isn't how it works. What? Well, if you know so much about it, why don't you go heal yourself? I'll make another appointment with somebody who will listen. You're wasting my time. Lots of it. They became fools. And no kidding. Our entire society is run by fools now. They're everywhere. I'll prove it to you. See that tree out there? It looks dead. Looks dead. See that tree on my lot here? That big one right there? Most of you don't never saw that tree. Well, anyway, there's a tree out right here. You can see it if you go to the window right there. It's right there. It looks dead. Somebody in the neighborhood complained about us. There's a dead tree in that church's lot over there. Well, somebody from the city, road scholar, comes driving by. Oh my God, there's a dead tree in there. I better cite them. So I got in the mail a citation. Blight citation. I'm a blighter. They cited me and gave me a court date, February 15. I have to go to court. If that tree's not cut down, I go to prison. For months, the zone, right down here. Total disaster area. The city went in every other day to haul out dead bodies. Drugs, feces, urine, trash, everywhere downtown. The businesses all got together. My God, why don't you do something? Who's going to clean this up? They sued the city. They won. The judge said the city had to go down and clean up the zone. Anybody ever seen that down there? Nobody saw it? It was unbelievable. Yeah. Yeah, downtown. Yeah. Tents everywhere. People sleeping in the street. Every other day, dead bodies. They would go in, clean out the dead bodies. Drugs all over the place. Needles everywhere. Right down here, just like San Francisco. And they cited me for a dead tree on the property. I got cited and a court date for blight. Blocks of filth. The city wouldn't clean up. Yeah, well, she deserved it. But what it is the point I'm trying to make is they became fools. The level of insanity and hypocrisy in our society is satanic. One guy filed a complaint, probably drove by. I don't like looking at that dead tree there. I don't want to file a complaint. Businesses, dozens of them downtown, begging the city, clean this place up. We're all going broke. No one comes down here anymore. Too much crime, too much drug. This is crazy. No, we're going to leave it. They became fools, number six. Number seven, they changed the glory of God. I just went over it. Yeah. Now just sit there, concentrate. What's Jesus saying to you? I've heard dozens of these stories, and the way you debunk them is you ask them what he looked like. What Jesus looked like? I don't remember. Now, wait a minute. You saw Jesus Christ, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. You saw him, and you don't remember what he looked like. What was he wearing? Whenever you're hearing in a counseling session, there's a gap there. What was he wearing? Roller skates or sandals? No details. Same thing with angels. Angel came in my room last night, was talking to me. What do you look like? It kind of looked like, was it male or female? No, it's a female. Where in the Bible are there female angels? Would you point that out to me? I think I'm being cited for blight. Stop it. Years ago, Wigglesworth was standing there at the bed with the lady dying. The guy's wife was laying in bed dying. This is the beginning of his ministry. He didn't know what to do. You read that story? He brought that other pastor with him. Remember that? The pastor starts praying because Wigglesworth didn't know how to pray. And the pastor started praying, "Oh, Lord God, Jesus, please be with her husband after her death. Oh, God, please bless the children after she's gone. Lord, please comfort his soul." Wigglesworth goes, "Stop! He looked up and there was Jesus. He said he had a little grin on his face and then he poofed, he was gone. He said he doesn't look like any picture he ever saw of him. It was the only time he ever appeared to him. Why'd that happen? Well, he was needed help. He was starting his ministry. This pastor was killing the woman by praying those prayers. And mercy, you know, stepped in and saw it. And then after that, there wasn't any need for Jesus to appear. Wigglesworth was ready to go. Didn't need to see anything. Wigglesworth became the apostle of sight? No, his nickname was the apostle of faith. He was the apostle of visions? No, he was the apostle of faith. Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things. Then Paul said they changed the truth into a lie. Oh, you imagine that? That looks like it came out of today's newspaper. Everything you see on TV is a lie. The government lies constantly. It's all lies. Everybody's lying. Now the worst lie of all is almost upon us. AI. The guy talking there is not even that guy. It looks and sounds just like it. It's all lies. Welcome to Antichrist kingdom. Now you see how he's going to control us. So easy to see. Guys in the preachers in the 50s could not see any of this we see now. We're living in the most exciting time you could possibly imagine and the most dangerous. The day is going to come where you can't be a casual Christian anymore. They're going to run over you. You gotta be ready to go. You must be equipped. They worship creation as God. Wow. They served creatures, not God. They submitted to vile passions. Oh my goodness. Women became lesbians. Men went to sodomy. This was thousands of years ago. People don't change. They're the same. People's as people. That's how they are. They rejected the knowledge of God. They became reprobate in their minds. Wow. They were completely perverted sexually. They were filled with iniquities. They despised the coming judgment. They glorified in wickedness. Oh my goodness. Las Vegas. Gambling sweeping the country. Did you know that consumer debt is greater than the national debt? A major financial collapse is coming. Everybody is broke. The government's broke. People are broke. Why? That's how we do it in America. Everybody just wants something, they buy it. They spend it. They can't control themselves. That's America. Every prosperous country goes through it, right? It eventually catches up with you. The old generation had to work for everything, they all die off. The current generation that has everything because of the ones that worked for everything, take it for granted. And they start dying off. That's what happened to this country. Second Thessalonians chapter 2. Paul's talking about the tribulation and the Antichrist and the false prophet. And then he says in verse 10, people will be infected with the deceivableness of unrighteousness. The Greek word is apate. It means they will be living in delusions. Now, when you're a kid, you know, delusions, they're not all bad. You know, when I was young, I wanted to be the middleweight champion of the world. I thought I would have made a good champion. In eighth grade, I had all kinds of delusions. I saw myself winning the championship, being interviewed after the fight. I went to the gym and hit the bags. I wanted to be champion. Eighth grader. It was a delusion. It wasn't going to happen. I just made it up. Yeah. As soon as I got out of the level of club fighting, I started to fight some real fighters and decided it was time to go to college. Wow, I got my ass kicked. But it was a delusion, and people have delusions. And some of them are harmless. But these he's talking about, they're not harmless. These are total destruction. Because they received not the love of the truth, so that they might be sozo delivered. That's going to be your biggest problem in your ministry, is trying to get truth across to somebody so they can get delivered. It's like pulling teeth out of yaks. It's almost impossible. For this cause, God shall send them a strong delusion. Plane is a Greek word. It means somebody who's going here and they take a wrong turn. Oh my gosh, I ended up where I wanted to go. You know, it's like Rodney Dangerfield said. You know, he gets lost and yells at a guy, and the only thing he ever hears is, "Oh, you're way off. Not in this town." Okay? Rodney was so far gone. They laughed at him. Well, that's what these people are. They're so far off the track. You're not even close. Plane. They're gone. That they should believe a lie. That they all might be krino, judged, who believed not the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. Hey, will you can you grab me a Bible in that cabinet there? Yeah, right behind you. I forgot to bring my Bible up here. See a Bible in there? Huh? About 100 Bibles? Oh gosh, now he's putting the pressure on me. Don't grab the Jehovah's Witness one. Yeah. All right, thank you. All right, the legendary Living Bible. How many remember that from the 70s? Anybody? Nobody? Okay. The Living Bible. This is not the one I wanted. But who knows? This might be a godsend here. And you know, in Matthew 24, Jesus gives all these predictions about what's going to happen in the future. This was 2,000 years ago he said this. And It's fascinating. They asked him, when will all this stuff happen? What are you talking about? And he goes, don't let anyone fool you, for many will come claiming to be the Messiah and will lead many astray. And when you hear of wars beginning, this does not signal my return. These must come, but the end is not yet. The nations and kingdoms of the earth will rise against each other, and there will be famines and earthquakes in many places. All this will be only the beginning of horrors. Then you will be tortured and killed and hated all over the world because you are mine. Many of you will fall back into sin and betray and hate each other. Many false prophets will appear and lead many astray. Plan A, wrong direction. Sin will be rampant everywhere and will cool the love of many. But those enduring to the end shall be saved. I just summed up your ministry. What you're trying to do is help this person that you're ministering to make it to the end. Paul likened it to a marathon. That's all we're doing. We're trying to get them to the end. Well, that's a debatable subject. Okay, so this part I'm going to read next is after the rapture, if the rapture comes before the tribulation, if it does. Nobody knows for sure. You know, I kind of lean toward pre-trib, but there's a good argument for post-trib. You know, it's a dogfight. But some of this, you know, is it during the tribulation? What we're going to read here, during the tribulation, whether the rapture happened or not, this is during the tribulation. And it says, but all this is only the beginning of sorrows. You will be tortured and killed and so on, and then the love of many will wax cold, and many false prophets will appear and lead many astray. Sin will be rampant everywhere and will cool the love of many, but those enduring to the end shall be saved. And the good news about the kingdom will be preached throughout the whole world, so that all nations will hear it. And then, finally, the end will come. Interesting. So when you see these horrible things told to you about Daniel, by Daniel the prophet, standing in a holy place, note to the reader, you know what this is meant. Then those in Judea must flee to the Judean hills. This is during the tribulation. That wasn't the rapture, was it? I don't think I'll read any more of this. Still don't look good. I'm not feeling good right now. Suddenly felt backslidden. It says here, those on your porches, don't even go down to get your stuff. Those in the fields, don't return to your homes and get your clothes. What he's saying there is urgently get out quick. Drop what you're doing and run for it. Woe to pregnant women in those days. Woe to women with babies. Pray your flight is not during the winter or on the Sabbath. There will be persecution such as the world has never seen before in all of its history and will never see again. See, now we're in tribulation here. In fact, unless those days are shortened, all mankind will perish, but they will be shortened for the sake of God's chosen people. Wow. Then if anyone tells you the Messiah has arrived at such and such a place or has appeared here or there, don't believe them. False Christs shall arise. False prophets shall arise. They will do wonderful miracles. And if possible, they would deceive God's chosen ones. See, I have warned you. So as we get closer to the end, there's going to be enormous demonic power spreading around the country, much worse than it is now. Supernatural power by demons. So if someone tells you the Messiah has returned and is out in the desert, don't bother to go look. Right now in Jerusalem, they are hiding the Messiah. They said he already came back. He's alive now and in Jerusalem. Right this second. He's here. He's a old rabbi. He looks like he's about older than me, like in his 70s or something. Have you seen him? Yeah. Well, I wouldn't put too much stock in that after reading this, would you? I don't think. We thought you'd been raptured out. I looked over there. I got scared. False Christ shall arise and prophet. They will do wonderful miracles. How can that be? That's why John said you got to test the spirits to see whether or not they are of God or not. Because a miracle doesn't mean it's God. You got to test the miracle. A vision doesn't mean it's God. You got to test it. A word doesn't mean it's God. You got to test it. Yes, sir. What do you say? Well, yeah, no, yeah, that doesn't work. When you ask somebody if Jesus is your Lord and Savior, they'll just say yes. That means nothing. No, that's not how you test it. Jesus said, by their fruits you will know them. Okay, so if she comes to church and gives her a word from God, God told me that you're supposed to do this and that. Okay, I'll receive that, but I'll just park it here. Park it. Until I get through two or three confirmations, until I check her out to see what kind of spiritual fruit she has. Okay. By their fruits, you will know them. Okay. In other words, don't take somebody's word for it, just point blank range. You're going to get in trouble. Yeah. Right. That's one of our future teachers here. Yeah, exactly right. It's got to line up with Scripture. Right? I'll give you an example. I was at the Dream Center one day, and this guy walks up to me, and he says, because I had mentioned to the guys, there's a bunch of spiritualism going around in the church. And I said, you're not to be involved in any of that. What you're to be involved in as an ex-addict is repenting of your sin and renewing your mind. You don't need to worry about anything else. You got to get the sin out of your life. You got to renew your mind on God's word. And you got to go through deliverance. Okay? What's happening with the rapture, the second coming? All this stuff. This is all a distraction. The demons are trying to drift you over here on some religious stuff to keep you from doing what you're supposed to be doing. You're an addict, and you're going to be here 6 to 9 months. They have two programs over there, 1 6 months, 1 9 months. And when you get out of here, there's a horde of spirits waiting for you. They're just standing in the parking lot waiting for goof A and goof B to get out. This group goes with goof A. This group goes with goof B. And you're going to relapse. You're going to relapse. Oh, what kind of teacher is this? Well, I'm a teacher with a dose of reality. Okay, if you don't repent of your sins and renew your mind, you're going to relapse. It's that simple. It can't be stopped. You think the devil's just going to stop bothering you because you went through a rehab program? At the Dream Center? What are you, stupid? They're in the Dream Center. He goes, well, there was a glory cloud in the Bible. I said, there was. Where's it at? Right here. He looks it up for me. I didn't even have to look it up. He read it and I said, see, that proves what I said. What did those priests do when the glory cloud came in? Oh my God, they collapsed. They crawled out of there. What are they doing over with the glory cloud over here? Jumping around, doing cartwheels, laughing and giggling. You see any problem with that? Never saw him again. He left the program. I kind of felt bad. Maybe I ran him out. But that's how delusions work. Oh, there's a glory cloud in the Bible. So this glory cloud's real. No. Everything is to be tried and tested. Test the spirits to see whether they're of God or not. That's what John said. He would be the expert, wouldn't he? The ultimate expert. The glory cloud in the Old Testament brought brokenness and humbleness and repentance. They crawled out of that temple. They weren't doing cartwheels and laughing and giggling and high-fiving. Oh, there it is. Don't you see that? It's all demonic entertainment. It's not real. The cloud's real, but the spirit behind it, fake, trying to distract you. You know, he still didn't receive that, even though he disproved himself. Now that's God working with me. I didn't even have to look it up. He disproved himself right in front of me. I see, he disproved exactly what I just taught 10 minutes ago. That's exactly what I said. His eyes crossed. He headed for the door. I never saw the guy again. He was never in another class. He disappeared. That hurt. If someone tells you the Messiah has returned and he's out in the desert, don't go out there. Don't bother to look. He's hiding in a certain place. Don't believe it. Here's how I'm going to come back, he says. Verse 27, for as lightning flashes across the sky from the east to the west, so shall my coming be when I, the Messiah, return. And wherever the carcasses are, there all the vultures will be gathered. What's he talking about there? Armageddon. Immediately after the persecution of those days, the sun will be darkened, the moon will not give its light, the stars will seem to fall from the heavens, and the powers overshadowing the earth will be convulsed. And then at the last signal of my coming will appear in the heavens, and there will be deep mourning around all the earth. I just described the goal of your ministry. People can't get delivered or healed if they're not sorry for their sin. If you don't have any godly sorrow, you're going to have a horrible time getting this person delivered. And usually people with self-pity, they don't have it. Because they see themselves as victims. Victims have a tough time having godly sorrow. And technically they are victims. Hey, it wasn't your fault. You were born in this rotten family with these crazy parents that had nothing to do with you. You were just dropped in a meat grinder. That's what happened to you. Okay, but after you've become a born-again Christian and you have the Holy Ghost, you can't be a victim anymore. Victims don't exist in Father's kingdom. You're making yourself a victim because your faith is weak. And so what I do when I'm trying to help somebody, I try to boost their faith. Somehow. Each case is different. But people that don't have any faith, they're always scared. Why? Because I got to rely on myself. I got to get through this myself. And that's scary. Because deep down, the person knows they're a failure. They can't do it. And I can't do anything. I got to have help. Holy Ghost help. And Jesus said, without me, you can do nothing. What an understatement. Wow, the older you get, the more you realize you can't do anything. You're not doing anything. Yeah, I see that all the time too. Well, I hear that mostly on number one, on the miracle list. I send out the miracle list. They always read number one. They don't read anything else. They just read number one. And they go, I got this covered already. Number one, you have to forgive the person. Number two, you have to get rid of the ought for the person. Ouch, the ought disappears out of the sentence. And they go, oh, I've already forgiven them. Your mind can forgive somebody. Your soul still hates. Okay, you didn't hear me. Your mind can forgive someone for abusing you, but your soul can still hate them. Jesus called that ought. And so I bifurcate that for them. To answer your question, that's usually the number one thing. I forgive them. I repented of that. You repented of it. Let's break that down for a minute. Now, did you have any deep remorse over what you did? No, I went to a church where they got greasy grace. So we just say a sinner's prayer and we ask for it. Oh, we're done. I'm fine. Okay, now that's gonna be a problem. Greasy grace is a disease that causes people not to have any godly sorrow because they hurt their Heavenly Father and they didn't know He loved them so much and they hurt Him and they don't care. They don't really care. They just want to block it out. I hear that. I forgave Him. I repented. Then the next one is, why don't even deliver to that? I took drugs 15 years ago. I'm not taking drugs anymore. You know, then you got to explain to them, look, I didn't ask you if you were doing drugs because I want to know if you're doing it now. I was looking for the entry point of the spirit that entered you. How did they get in years ago? That's all I'm looking for. I'm trying to get this person to understand that the symptoms they're having now were caused by a spirit that entered them when they were five. Well, I forgave my dad. You forgave your dad, but the beating was the door open for the spirit to get in, and he's still in there. And you came here for deliverance. We got to get that thing out of there. And that's the secular church, the apostate church. That's what they teach. Did you repent of it? Yep. Ah, you're clean. God forgave you. Forgiveness of sin is different from deliverance from demons. Those are two different things. So it depends on what the person gives me. Then I come back with trying to explain it to them spiritually. The biggest one is the mother or dad curse. Did you trash your parents when you were young? Yep, but I get along great with them now. We're lovey-dovey. Great, but that curse still fell on you. That's why everything's still going wrong. Finances, family, divorce, relationships, all. Pfft. Just because you become friends with somebody and forgive them doesn't remove a curse. Drug addicts have huge curses. Why? All they did was lie and cheat to their parents. They milked everything out of them to get high. Then they milked everything out of their friends to get high. And then they stole from their employer, got high. Then they went here and got high. Everybody, they cut off all their associates. They have nothing left. Now they're in rehab and they think they're fine because they repented. They don't understand how the spirit world works. You can still be cursed and be born again. But now that you're born again, you get that curse broke off of you. Nowhere in the Bible here does it say that once you become a born again Christian, the demons automatically leave and your curses automatically disappear. And your mind's completely renewed. Now you're a Christian. It's not in there. There's no scripture in there that says that. So if you were raised a Mormon, wow, we got bad problems here. Well, I'm saved now. I don't go to that church. Okay. That's what they'll tell you. I'm good. I'm glad you're saved. I'm glad. But they got in when you were young. You used to be a Mormon. You believed all that. How did you believe that? Click. They got in your head. They just lied. Immediately after the persecution of those days, the sun will be darkened. The moon will not give light. The stars will seem to fall from the heavens, and the powers overshadowing the earth will be convulsed. And then at last the signal of my coming will appear in the heavens. There will be deep mourning all around the world, and the nations of the world will see me arrive in the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. And I will send forth my angels with a mighty trumpet blast, and they will gather my chosen ones from the furthest ends of the earth and heaven. That means there has to be Christians on the earth at the time he comes back. Now learn a lesson from the fig tree. When her branch is tender and the leaves begin to sprout, you know summer is almost here. Everybody's read this, right? Now, this is during the tribulation. This isn't last Tuesday. Just so, when you see all these things happening, beginning to happen, you can know that my return is near, even at the door. Then, at last, this age will come to an end. Wow. No one knows the date and hour when the end will come, not even the angels, not even me, only the Father knows. Then he goes on to explain, just like the flood caught Noah, caught everybody that didn't listen to Noah off guard, and they kept doing the same thing they were always doing until the day Noah entered the ark. He says it'll happen again. Two men will be working together in the field. One will be taken, the other left. Two women going about their business, the household. One taken, the other left. So be prepared, for you don't know what day your Lord is coming. Just as a man can prevent trouble from thieves by watching for them, you can also avoid trouble by always being ready for my unannounced return. I just described your ministry. What you're doing, you're helping this person get spiritually ready for the end. Because the end is coming. That's your job, to get them ready to go. They're spiritually ignorant. They don't know what they're doing. They don't understand spiritual things. And they're trusting you to help them. You have to help them. There's nobody else to help them. The churches can't help them. They don't understand it. You understand. There's someone else influencing them. Somebody hiding in there. Somebody drives them back to sin, back to porn, back to food, back to booze. Somebody wants them to run. Somebody wants them to panic. Somebody's doing that in there. And you got to get them out of there. But we can't do it, obviously, if they're not going to cooperate and not going to repent. Okay? I just got an email in this morning from a guy who used to come here off and on for years. The name is Justin. He's seen everybody on the ministry staff. I've forgiven him 3 times, allowed him to come back. Nothing more. Nothing. Sends me an email this morning, reaming me out. That brings us to our next category of ministry. Romans 1:28. Here it is. You ready? Justin sent me an email today. Here he is. Romans 1:28. Even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind. Adokamas. What is that? That means somebody's mind that can't absorb any truth. Discarded, a trashed out mind. When that happens, they're done. Zombies, the living dead.
Okay, so if you're trying to minister to this kind of individual, do you just stop? Because I have a friend who he's a Geno Jennings fan. I don't know if you're familiar with him.
Geno Jennings? Who's that? Yeah.
And he's sort of a victim mentality. He made a comment that no one ever really listens to him. And he'll never come down here for deliverance because, one, he doesn't need it. And, two, you're frightened of him because he's going to give you a piece of his mind.
Have I met him?
Pardon me?
Have I met him? He may be right.
Maybe. he's going to read you because he will never get deliverance. Because you've had multiple marriages, and the Bible says that if your ex-wife is still alive, that you committed adultery if you're remarried, and he, every time we have a conversation, we go full circle back to this marriage thing, and I'm like, again, dude, with the marriage thing, I go, Mike Smith is trying to help people, and that's good enough for me. I said, is that good enough for you? No, I ain't talking to that guy. He's a sinner. And I would like to help this guy, but I'm completely lost.
Well, what's happening is, first of all, that's the only person that feels that way about me. The demons are using that guy to get him jacked up. It's a total setup. Because he is an adokamas. Now, are we 100% sure he is? No, because the only way to be sure is if something really bad happens to the person and they won't repent. So if God breaks them and they still don't repent, that's probably a reprobate mind. They're gone. But he sounds like a reprobate mind, but I can't 100% say that he has one. There may be hope for him, but not until he's broken and he's really desperate to cry out for God. But right now, the devil's job is to screw him up. And they keep sucking him in because he wants to help them. You got to sometimes know when to hold them and when to fold them for your own safety. And that's what I did to Justin. I got rid of him 3 times. I took him back again. He got mad at me again. Sent me another nasty one. I said, Justin, look, please do not contact me or anybody on my staff again. We are not able to help you. I'm so sorry. Cut. A cut. You wait to God to make a move on him. If you keep trying to help people that won't listen, it's a trick. You're going to wear yourself out. What's that? Oh, of course. Yeah, Derek Prince had thousands of good teachings, much better than mine. But well, see, whatever the devil says to you, it doesn't matter what he says to you. Who cares what the devil thinks of you? In fact, if he doesn't like you, that's an asset. Because it means he doesn't have you. If you're being attacked and tempted, good for you. Start signing autographs. Because that means he doesn't have you. Okay. A reprobate mind. You're going to run into them all the time. Particularly now with our society. Pot it out. Pot is sweeping the country. And the stuff coming in from Mexico, the THC thing is so high now that people are having instant or near instant hallucinations smoking reefers. And did you see the lady last week? She stabbed her boyfriend 101 times. They found 101 stab wounds in that kid. And they charged her for second degree murder. And the defense provided quite a bit of testimony about THC, its effects on her, the high potency in the pot she was smoking. They had been smoking all day together. And she had an hallucination and stabbed the guy 101 times. Just a pool of blood all over. You can imagine what that looked like. Horror. She got 2 years probation. Imagine that. That's how sick this is now. Pot is everywhere. And for years, everybody knew how damaging that drug was. THC is, that's going to jack you up. Now it's all over the place. Legal. Imagine that. Everybody knew pot ruined your mind. Everybody knew that. Not anymore. You can murder your boyfriend and get 2 years probation with community service. Wouldn't you be chomping at the bit to get her to come over to your charity to work? Can't wait. I would reassign her to the landfill. Just a thought. It just popped in my head. I think it was divine thought. This society is sick. Everybody knows gambling is a horrible sin. Everybody knows that. Everybody for decades knew gambling was a horrible vice. They call it a vice. It's all legal now. Imagine that. Gambling. Legal. Nationwide. That's unreal. Almost seems like a dream. Pot and gambling everywhere. That's Satan doing that. No human could possibly accomplish that. He's behind this. This takes a supernatural level of intelligence to accomplish this kind of stuff. He's moving. I just read it to you. America's going to hell in a handbasket. But Acts chapter 2 says there will be a great revival before the second coming. Okay? That's not going to help us out right now because that's during the tribulation. We need one here now. Okay? And we can get one too. That's why Mike is having the prayer meetings over. That's why you're going to change your life and start increasing your devotional time, aren't you? You're going to ramp it up. See? Your anointing follows your devotional time. This stops and that stops. Click. We're getting a lot of people here with reprobate minds, severe bipolar, schizophrenia, dissociative identity disorder. They're flooding in the doors. Those are the people most likely to be a reprobate. You can't get a scrap of truth into them. Here's how it works. Here's what the Bible says. A, B, C. Oh, that sounds good. How you doing? 2 days later, boom, crashed. Okay, come on in. Now, here's what the Bible said. Remember, A, B, C. Right? I mean, you're not going over deep theology, but you're getting just a little bit of truth trying to get in. See, here's how it works. That. Okay? A, B, C. Kindergarten. Oh, I see it now. 6 hours later. Oh! What happened? Oh, somebody said this. Somebody called me. Somebody. Okay, come back in. Now, remember A? Oh, so stay on A then. Pretty soon, you're lowering your standards because this person can't last 24 hours. Literally. That literally happens. Yeah. And you got to have the patience of Job with these sick people because they can't take in any truth. They can't absorb it. Their minds have been taken. A reprobate mind. Gone. How you doing, Dave? Good. I turned my life back over to the Lord. Oh, okay, good. You were backslidden again? Yeah, I backslid every 6 months. Every time you backslide, your mind sinks there. Backslide again, it goes there. And one day, it's down here in the reprobate neighborhood. And you can't come back. What do I think about who?
What do you think the difference is between those two groups of people? Those that are willing to pursue deliverance.
Well, that's a good question. And take it on an individualized basis. Some people are theologically opposed to it because they've been brainwashed into thinking that Christians can't have demons. Others of them are scared. They've come here several times. A few hundred people over the years have come to his services, and they see people acting. Were you at the altar call last night? Okay, if anybody from my old profession, you know, therapists, counselors, if they were to come in the door, they'd call the police on us. There's a cult down there on Mulberry. It's the Mulberry cult. I saw a rack of mentally ill people standing down there. Some weird white guys running around yelling. They'd come down here to investigate. And of course, I should refer them to Kelly, but people look around and they see deliverance, and some of them get scared. It scares them. Well, that's the demon in there. He's going, he's scared. I got to get out of here before they catch me. See? He sees his other buddies getting their faces kicked in, and he bolts. That's a smart move. But some people are afraid of it. They're scared. The third group doesn't understand anything. You know, some people are dumb. They have low IQs. They can't process stuff very fast. They're very slow learners, so you got to feed them a cookie here, and then another cookie in 2 days. Other people are rapidly, well, they'll just absorb it quickly. They grow fast, right? Parable of the sower. Some of it falls on the wayside here, on the trail. And the demons come, boop, 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 boop. Easy pickings. See, that's a reprobate mind. Okay, you're having bad thoughts about your mother, cookie. Okay, that's going to get you in trouble, right? Yes. Okay, when you have a bad thought about your mother, you're going to have to take that thought captive, right? Yes. That's Monday. Tuesday, I hate my mother. Whoa, come back in. Cookie time. There's your mother. Now you have a bad thought about your mother. We went over this last Monday and the Monday before and the Wednesday before that. But now we're on cookie six. And that's how it is with people that are heading toward Reprobatesville. They can't absorb any truth. Adokamas. It's not able to stick in there, you know. It's like it just rolls off. Well, it's the demons in them, and it's the pattern of thinking that they've developed inside the person's brain from childhood to now, usually through abuse, neglect, abandonment, different things. This is how they think, adokamas. A reprobate mind thinks in a certain pattern, and the pattern is so strong, you can't get through to them. They're now zombies. Over the years, the most depressing thing is people brings people here to get healed. They bring them here. And they brought them too late. They can't absorb any truth at all. They can't listen to anything more than 10 minutes. They drift off again. Gone. But had they been here the following year or something, when they still had more of their faculties operating, we could have saved them. Justin sent me another email. You guys do deliverance wrong. We don't do it. You're not supposed to do it the way you do it. He went on and he straightened me out. Well, you know, that's the 50th time. Justin, I'm sorry, we can't help you anymore. You know, don't contact any of us ever again. I don't want anybody on my staff having to burn rubber taking care of Justin. Gone. Yeah.
But they really keep calling out for help. Like, is there something?
Well, that could be two things. A, the person may not be totally gone. B, the demons want you to help them. So they're always calling out for you. It's a trick. Yeah.
That's the definition of a plant.
A plant, yeah. They're a plant.
They're just to wear us out.
Yeah, a plant. If they're sincere and they're truly trying, then I'll stay with them. I'll go to the cabinet. I'll break out another bag of cookies. Now here's a cookie. Okay, you don't like your cousin. Okay, remember you. Why don't you like your cousin? Because you had negative thoughts about your cousin, right? Oh yeah, I don't like what he did and said and went and do. Okay, now when we forgive someone. Here's another cookie. When you forgive them, you release that from them, what they did to you. Remember? Oh, I remember. Yeah. Yeah, got it. And that's how bad it is. I'm not even joking. And then the next day, I read about him in the paper. I killed my cousin. Oh, wait a minute. We went over that. Some gal over at CFTN, she did kind of sozo deliverances. She made the horrible mistake of trying to sozo, a schizophrenic. Remember that? What was that, 4 years ago? 3 years ago? 3 years ago? 4 years ago? 5 years ago? Yeah, well this schizophrenic lived in Tucson. So this gal over at CFTN, loving, warm-hearted, caring person, come up from Tucson. She would have her do sozo in her home. And she didn't understand true deliverance and didn't understand reprobate minds. She wasn't getting it. So she had this false belief in her head that sozo could help this person. And then, you know the story. On the next visit, she shot her in the back. She opened the door. Come on in, sweetheart. Boom! Shot her in the back and killed her. She went to the state hospital. And see, where'd she go? Tucson. She went to a mental health clinic in Tucson. Then had a plea deal. And she got, was it 10 months in prison? 9 or 10 months in prison for killing that deliverance minister at CFTN. They were devastated. But again, she didn't understand schizophrenia. She didn't understand sozo doesn't work on mentally ill people. You're going the wrong direction. But she was a beautiful woman, loving heart. Great gal, great person. Huge loss, huge loss. Reprobate mind. Got to be able to spot them.
Do you have an example of somebody that you helped? They just kept going back, but eventually they just got it and they're now booming.
Dave Baldwin. Yeah, it's schizoaffective.
So he
kept going. Wouldn't quit.
No, I mean somebody that just, they weren't getting it.
They weren't getting it.
They were not getting it. They seemed like a plan, but then eventually they finally got it.
Oh, yeah. Oh, they finally got it?
Yeah, eventually after.
Yeah, Dave Baldwin.
He was like that?
Yeah. Yeah. Nick. Mm-hmm. Nick was worse. Oh, screwing up. Oh, wrote the book on screw up.
So you can't ever just write anyone off.
No, I write them off. I wrote off Justin, but I saw Dave and Nick. There was something in there that was working, real. Some sincerity. Say, you got to make that judgment. You got to use your discernment. Justin, do not contact us again. I gave him 3 chances. That's it. So it's your discernment that's going to determine whether or not these people should be dumped or you keep working with them. We're working with a gal, Jennifer, severe mentally ill. She does great with her. She makes a lot of progress. And then, kaboom. And, you know, I was praying about it last week. I said, Lord, do you want me to get rid of her? Because I don't want Jennifer to start drinking. And I talked it over with Jennifer. And she said, she had quit drinking a couple days ago. And I said, since you stopped a couple days ago, why don't you go ahead and keep helping her? But I thought, even if this isn't working out right, it's good training for Jennifer, you know. So I had an ulterior motive. You got to make a decision. So this gal here, our decision was we're going to keep inching forward with her. And because there's some evidence of genuine desire in the woman. She's not a reprobate mind. She's headed that way. No question. Right? But hey, we're still working with her. Yeah.
The gentleman that I brought up.
Yeah.
Should I send him this teaching?
Send him what?
Today's teaching.
You're a troublemaker, aren't you? Yeah.
Well, when Joe just asked that question, I was considering raising my hand.
You leave Joe alone.
Okay.
No, I wouldn't send him anything. Don't throw your pearls in front of swine. Okay, I told Justin, don't contact us again. You've already cleaned out my pearl box, and then you trampled on him, and then you turned on me. Just exactly what Jesus said. They'll trample your pearls and they'll turn on you. That's happened to me dozens of times over the years. You're turning on me?
No. For what we're talking about, you know, I had that case last week where I spent 4 hours with somebody and he came in and he didn't know who Jesus really was.
Right.
Before that night, he was the Lord. He tried some deliverance.
Mm-hmm. No.
It was a positive for me and Erica. It was a positive experience. Everything went well. But then you get this email. It was what? Like a totally negative experience for this guy. But he's mentally ill.
Mm-hmm.
So for something like that, would you just go back and try again? Or?
Yeah, I'm calling him tonight.
Okay.
Yeah, I already got it scheduled.
Okay.
Yeah. I'll give him a couple of whacks, hit him a few times to see if they are not a reprobate, if there's any hope there. So what I usually do is if someone's already seen them, then I call them up and I bring the club in. And I hit them hard, right in the face. Well, I just give them nasty truth. I just tell them the absolute truth. You are a sick, sad loser, and you're going to die in a mental institution, and you won't even know your mother's name. You're headed to oblivion. Now, you got a chance to change. You better change now. That kind of stuff, that's what it kind of looks like. I blast them. I'm doing it because I care about them. You can't keep patting somebody on their fanny. They're just sink.
Well, the person I'm working with, when I started to do that and bring the hammer down,
mm-hmm.
she responded.
Yeah, she responded. Some will respond, some won't. Like a foreground.
Yeah.
And the demons come and take the seeds, right? That's a mentally ill person. You put the seed in their mind, and then the next day, they forgot it, and they don't do it. See, it got picked up on it was on the path, and the birds came and got it just like that. And a mentally ill person, you put truth in there, they come in there and take it right out. See, then I got to dump it in again. Eat your cookie. Starting over. See, you got to tell them for the 50th time. Right? Patience is the key for everything, you and them. Yes, sir.
Supposed to recruit somebody in spirit of mildness, right? However, Jesus wasn't always mild, that's his heart. So, in your experience, is it better if one of us takes the initiative and goes, hey, you know, I need to get a little tough with you, man, but we need to have a serious heart here, or should we refer him to somebody else and try to keep that, hey, I'm a shoulder you can cry on, I'm going to let somebody else lead you up. I mean, I'll be
No, I just do both. You got to be a chameleon. So if I need to kiss somebody's butt for a while, I'll do that. If I have to get tough on them, then I kick that in. I mix it up. Yeah, you need to do it. You need to do everything. You need to do it, learn to do everything, because you have that ability. Wigglesworth was a butt kicker. But then he would be weeping over somebody at the prayer line. See, he'd be harsh with this guy, and then he would cry over that one. That's how you do it. That's the Holy Spirit. He's like that too. He gets tough with people, and then he just... and he just helps them. That's how he does it. Perfectly. He's got all the skills. He's got everything I wish I had. Everything I wish I had. He has. Main thing is you got to be patient and have compassion for people. That's the main thing. If you don't have that, please don't get in the ministry.
Well, it's my heart to think that I have to be worried about transfer spirits when all I want to do is hug them and pray for them.
Well, that's a tough question to answer because I don't know you that well and I don't know those people that well. Okay, but the Tenderloin District, there's fallen angels down there. They're not regular demons like we get here. That's the major leagues. Okay, so I would be careful if I were you. Yeah. You don't want to go into the Tenderloin District unless you got some packing anointing. I wouldn't even go down there. I would be careful if I was you. You're in the major leagues down there. Major leagues. You're not in the minor leagues anymore. This is Pop Warner around here. You go to the Tenderloin, oh, wow. Them are real demons down there. They murder people all the time in Tenderloin. Right? The dead bodies all, wow. That's Satan's domain. Yeah. I don't go around picking fights. I wait for them to come to me here. Or I get an email. You don't do deliverance right. Okay. I can handle that. Tenderloin District, I need to pray for a while before I go down there. Let me work on that. Well, Brother Mike's a coward. Well, no, it's not cowardice. I'm just trying to use a little wisdom here. You know. Enthusiastic people will run places where angels won't go. And sometimes you can be ignorant or presumptive and you can get caught. Some ex-voodoo priestess could be down in Tenderloin. You wouldn't know them. They look semi-normal. You can't trust anybody down there. That is a living hell down there. Everybody dying. It's frightening. Much worse than we had down here at the zone. That's a gigantic coven, isn't it? There's everything down there. Witchcraft, sorcery, murderers, killers, drugs. Everybody's down there, Tenderloin. Yeah, I'd get prayed and fasted up before I'd go down there. I wouldn't even go down there. I'd prep. Yeah, prep. There's nothing wrong with that. You're supposed to prep. You know, thinking you can handle every case everywhere anytime. You're a fool. That's arrogance. That's spiritual arrogance. No. You proceed with caution. You watch out for yourself. You take care of yourself. Okay. Well, I got the blood. Oh, God, when I hear that, I start panicking. I'm covered with the blood. Oh, my gosh. That's somebody who has very limited experience in any of this. They just run blindly down. I'm fine. You know, some of these ministers are like Fredo on The Godfather. I got passed over, Mike. I'm smart. Fredo was the idiot of the family. He was a certified goof. He never got any jobs. Nobody trusted him with anything, but he thinks he's smart. That was a funny joke. I just wish somebody would have seen that movie. I could have been able to write to it. I got to get some better examples. But that's arrogance. He had arrogance. He thought he was a Corleone. And being a Corleone, he was smart, like the other brothers. He wasn't stupid. He didn't have any common sense. Right? People with common sense don't have common sense, live miserable lives. Everything is a problem for them. Constant struggle. And God gave you common sense when he created you. It comes out of your mind and you learn from experience and you make adjustments. You improvise, you adjust, you adapt. No, that's our goal. Had it happen thousands of times. Yes. Yeah, get them away from me. Yes. Yeah, and then they'll get sicker. You're not a cure-all to everybody. You can't handle every case. Nobody can. Jesus could, but I cannot. Okay, so you got to not think of yourself more highly than you ought to think, is the way Paul worded it. So Dirty Harry worded it differently. A man's got to know his limitations. It's the same thing, similar thing. You know, everybody has limits. Nobody knows everything. The Holy Ghost does. I'm talking about people. No person knows everything. So you're going to make mistakes, you know. And you can't be hard on yourself. You have to make a mistake and learn from it, and then you move forward. That's how you do it. And you can only do that if you get out of your comfort zone. And Americans don't like that. People in Africa, when I went over there, everybody was out of their comfort zone. There wasn't any comfort anywhere. Everybody had a hard life. Here in America, no. Not here. We got the good life over here. The good life makes you weak. That's the way humans are. Happened to Rome. And they had the good life and everybody got weak. The Goths and the Visigoths took them. They lost everything. Remember? Yeah. They got weak. It's human nature. The best way to do it is what Arnold Schwarzenegger said in his movies. Stay hungry. If you stay hungry, you'll always be a learner and you'll always be moving forward. The devil gets you when you get complacent and lazy. Man, you need to be terminated. If you stay hungry, you can make it. And it happens to everybody. The devil gets them. Football teams, pro athletes, fighters, they get here, they start to get a little complacent. I've made it. And if your attitude is you never make it, you'll always be moving forward. You'll always be a learner. That's the way you do it. And you do it by not thinking of yourself more highly than you ought to think. You keep yourself in perspective. Yeah, I don't know everything. I don't have all the skills. I'm not a great person. I'm going to just be a servant, and I'm going to keep moving forward and seeing how many people I can help this month. Keep chalking them up. Some of them will fall off. I sat in a meeting one time with a realtor, and he gave us a pitch about selling properties. This is back in the 80s. He goes, sometimes you'll make some sales, you put them up on the board, some of them will fall off. He said, don't worry about it, just keep putting them on the board. And I never forgot that. He was right. Spiritually, that's how it works. You just keep putting them on the board. Some of them are going to fall off. But you put it back, put another one back out there and keep going. You can win it. It's part of our nature to get fat, stupid, and ugly, and dumb. That's man's fallen nature. He always goes down. But spiritually, you can stop that with the Holy Ghost. Wigglesworth did. He was always hungry for something more from God.
That's right along the same line of getting puffed up.
Well, it could be, yeah, but some people just kind of have a general sense that they're doing great. They're really a special person. And other people are puffed up. That's more like arrogance. Okay. Paul was talking about the other one was kind of the sense you have of yourself that you're kind of here and I'm kind of there. That's what Paul didn't like. So he said, I came to you. I made my own tents. I did my own work. I got my own food. And I did that so you wouldn't call me a TV preacher, whoring myself out for money. Essentially what he was saying. Rewording it. Because he wanted to maintain his credibility with the people he was trying to save. So they couldn't point a finger at him. Oh, you're looking for money. No, I worked. I bought my own food. Paul. Did E.F. Hutton just come in here? Because it feels like everybody got quiet. That was a funny joke, if anybody remembered that ad, but nobody did. Oh, it was years ago. Okay, I'll forgive you. But I got to work on the ought. Any other questions before we go to prayer? Uh-huh. Right. Well, the context of the text that you were talking about was different, the context of the verse. So if you take a verse out of here, verse here, and then compare them, sometimes you can get off the track. Because every verse is in context written. So the context of the text may have a different meaning. Instead of pulling it out, clicking it. That's how you come up with false doctrines. Real easy to do. Right? So the context of that was, Paul was saying, look, you know, you got to have some discernment and anointing to run around putting your hands on people. Okay, so this is what happens in the prophetic churches. They go through fire tunnels. Everybody's going through the tunnel. This guy puts his hand on her. Then that guy puts his hand on her. Then another guy puts it. This guy was on porn 2 days ago. He puts his hand on her. This one just had a big fight with her husband. She puts his hand on her. Okay, Paul said, don't let people you don't know who they are start spiritually putting their hands. I'm not talking about shaking hands or giving somebody a hug. That's just a human thing. There's no problem with that. It's the spiritual aspect of it, what he was warning Timothy about. Because Timothy was a young minister. He's trying to get him schooled and keep him from getting a transfer. You wouldn't go to the Tenderloin District and ask the pastor down there, would you mind praying for me? Whoa! Just pray for me over there. I'll stay over here, pastor. See? Don't. Well, the Bible said I'm supposed to put hands on. Let me help you with your hands. Put your hands on there. And here's a machete. Don't put your hands on me. Okay? But in Mark 16, now that was the great commission of the church. And he was generally saying to us, we have authority over doing the first thing, which is casting out demons. It was the first thing listed. Right? See, the context of the two verses she quoted was different. So read the text in context first, and then you won't get caught with a mistake or a false idea. So over the years, over your experience, then like Wigglesworth, you would know what kind of anointing you have because you had years of experience seeing the results of you praying for people. Remember that one scene where he was at that giant rally and there were 3,000 people there? Remember that one? And he cried out to God. He said, what am I going to do? You know, I can't put my hands on everybody and pray for them. Remember that? The Lord spoke to him and said, hey, have that woman stand over there on that stump. And then he had everybody that needed healing. Look over to that woman over there. And then God swept through the thing healing people because he couldn't get to them. And he had a mindset where he did healing lines. And God was expanding him, his mind, to a Catherine Kuhlman-ish type thing, where you don't pray for anybody. The Holy Ghost is moved. See that? So he was kind of training Wigglesworth. Everybody needs training, no matter how powerful you are spiritually. Nobody knows everything. Not one. I've never met one person who knows everything. Far from it. I've come close a couple of times. Any more laying on hands questions? Listen, you can pray your guts out for somebody, but if they don't believe in divine healing or they don't think they have any demons, it's not going to work. So if I'm doing deliverance on somebody and nothing's happening, I stop it and then I kind of redo my investigation. Do you think you have demons? And most of the time they'll say no. I don't think so, they'll say. That's how they word it. I don't think so. Well, that think so is blocking my afternoon because they're not coming out. Because it could go either way. In his mind, he's saying, well, I might want. A double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. Double-minded people, you can't get them delivered. Can't get them saved either. Because they're waffling. Well, I don't know. Jesus sounds pretty good. I think I'll get saved with him. Who's up next week? Buddha's coming. Oh, well, let me check Buddha out. Well, you're waffling. That ain't going to work. The double-minded man flops between Jesus and Buddha. Forget it. You can't do that. You either believe in it or you don't. Lord, my son's got autism and a bunch of disabilities. If you can help us, please have compassion. If you can do it. What do you say? If you can believe. All things are possible. Him that believes. Well, they're not healed yet. Well, hey, you got to investigate that. There's a reason they're not healed. What's the reason? Is it a curse? Is it witchcraft? Is it unbelief? Is it doubt? Is it bad teaching? You know, go down your little checklist and see if you can figure out what's going on in that mind of theirs. Because the mind dictates where we go. How a man thinks in his heart, so is he. Proverbs 27. And you can't think for somebody. You can give them help, but ultimately it's their job to think for themselves. And that's what the devil and the federal government doesn't want you to do. They won't want people thinking for themselves. Too dangerous. But you're not going to think that way because you have the mind of Christ. And that means the devil is going to get his face kicked in by you. God called you to be a killer. Right? For this purpose was the Son of God manifested, that he might destroy works of the devil. Whoa. What devil works? There's the wayside. They hear truth. Boop, 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 boop. They come right by and snatch it out. The next day, hey, I'm back to where I was. There's good ground and there's bad ground, right? Those are humans. The ground is the humans. So you got wayside ground, stony ground, thorn ground, and good ground. Okay? Good grounds are the ones who receive the word with joy and gladness. And they go forth producing 40, 60, 80, 100-fold, 200-fold. Okay, well, you're going to get good grounds once in a while. God's mercy sends you one, okay? Because he knows that you can't keep working wayside cases or you're going to quit. You're going to get exhausted, worn out, and discouraged. So the good Lord will give you some good ground. And they get healed and delivered right out of the gate. They leave and you yell at them, come back. I got the wayside all over. Right? And then some of them do great for a while, and then the thorns creep up. The family, the spouse, the kids, the job, the oh my God. What happened to you? You were doing so well. Thorns got them. My brother's a nut. My family's crazy. My mom's a whack job. Thorns. Gotcha. Crazy family members are like thorns. If you give into it, you lose. See, we're supposed to be seated in heavenly places in Christ, not sitting down with all the losers. Right? That's the Greek word epironios. It means the atmosphere. We're supposed to be sitting up here, looking down on these crazy people. We are not down there with the crazy people. We are not crazy anymore. We're in heavenly places in Christ. We go down there to save them, then we come back up there. Then we go to save that one, then we go back up here. We don't live down in Ratsville anymore. That's what he meant, heavenly places. Not heaven, we're not there yet. They go there after we die. We're in heavenly places now, spiritually. Spiritually, we're here. Not down here in the rat hole. We were saved from that. See, the vomit's down here. We're not going back to our vomit. We can't afford it. Besides that, the rapture is just a few years away now. This thing's almost over. It's going down. Can't you see it? It's clear as a bell. Anti-Semitism sweeping the country. But that's exactly what the Bible says is going to happen. everybody's going to abandon the Jews. We're their only real friend, and we're going to be gone. Says it right in Revelation. Israel's evacuating. The Antichrist, they're evacuating Israel to get out. Everybody left them. Us. We leave them. We're not there in Revelation. We're not there. You can see it happening, can't you? Everybody's yelling at the Jews right now. You need to stop fighting. You're killing it. Everybody's turning on them. That's just textbook anti-Semitism. It's predicted and it's going to happen. But they're not going to be totally destroyed because of the lightning. Comes from the east and the west, so shall the coming of the Son of Man be. He saves them in the nick of time. Like he did us. God, he saved us. Somebody threw me a life raft you wouldn't believe. I was in big trouble. I was so lost. So sick. Mercy hunted me down like a dog. Bloodhound got me. Mercy. I don't know what I would have done. And my daughter not showed up. I don't know where I'd be now. I was so lost. I was so gone. Somebody came for me. I didn't deserve anything. I should have been farmed out. Trashed. I shouldn't be standing here. There's no way I should be standing here. I was garbage, human garbage. Mercy knocked on my door. Somebody came for me. Somebody hunted me down. I didn't come to him. I didn't come to him. He hunted me down. Somebody threw me a life raft. It's unbelievable. I should have never been saved. I should be in hell right now. That's what I deserved. I didn't get justice. I got mercy. Mercy. It's hard to believe. It's hard to believe I could be saved. It's ridiculous. God's ridiculous. People he saves. It's unreal. So, I guess all the years I've been able to relate to these people. Knowing that I was scum. I should have never had anything. Grace found me. That's the only hope I had. Nothing. I had nothing. No hope. Hopeless. Gone. Chock full of demons. It was over for me. All over for me. Out of the blue, my daughter, dad. Your dad's supposed to save your daughter, not the other way around. God sent my little girl to me. Hey, Dad. You're living in sin, Dad. That's what she said to me. I felt something stick me right here. It was love that stuck me. I got so stuck. I was mad when she first said it, but then something started bothering me. Conscience or something. My daughter is not the kind of person to mince words. You're living in sin, Dad. Well, how dare you talk to me like that? She couldn't have been more right. I was headed for a devil's hellfire. God hunted me down. Hey, that's how he works. Anybody can be saved if you can only believe. Only believe. Let's pray then. Thank you, Jesus, for this meeting every month. I love it. It's my favorite meeting. And I believe you're ready, Lord. I think you're always ready. I really do. There are some people here today that need a touch from the Holy Ghost. I said the Holy Ghost because they don't need a touch from me because I can't help anybody. I don't have anything. I don't have a thing. I pray, Lord, that every person here that's got a kind of a hard heart, they've had a hard life, and they've had many misfortunes, a lot of heartache, and they've gotten kind of hard-hearted. Because they did it because they had to survive. They had to be tough to survive. Things were bad and things were difficult and abusive. And they had to get hard-hearted just to survive, just to be tough. I pray you will melt them right now, Lord. I pray you will melt them in Jesus' name right now. Right now, Lord. Sweet Holy Spirit, I want you to move right now. Somebody who's arrogant, somebody who's got a hard heart, somebody who's scared. Break through that barrier, I pray. Strike them down like you did me. Cried my eyes out for hours, crying for mercy. The Holy Ghost conviction is the greatest thing you could ever have in your life. Conviction is God's biggest expression of love. Conviction. If he's still convicting you, it means he still loves you. If you never hear from the Lord and you never get convicted, that's a red flag. What I was talking about earlier, it may be a reprobate mind. Not always, but it's possible. You got to pray through. You got to fight for your life. That's what's required. You've got to fight for your life. This is a war. And you have to win. You have to win it. Lord, I pray for my sister here, ministering in the tenderloin. If she unwittingly or unknowingly picked up a transfer spirit from some psycho down there in that district, that spirit must come out today. I pray for every person here who has a hard heart, hardened heart. Oh, Lord, God, forgive me. God, forgive me. God, forgive me. The eyes of the Lord go to and fro over the whole earth, looking for somebody whose hearts, that's who he's looking for. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, dear Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I pray you'll move now, Holy Spirit. Touch my friends. They're all my friends. We're friends here, but we're looking for you. We're looking for Jesus. We're looking for the Holy Ghost. That's it. Nothing else. Absolutely nothing else. Lord Jesus, have mercy. I pray for everyone here tonight, today, that has bad habits. You got bad habits. You developed bad habits when you were young, or when you were a kid. Bad habits. I pray you'll bless them today. I pray for every person here who doesn't like themselves. I can relate to that. I know all about it. It's a fate worse than death. Hating yourself. Seeing yourself deficient and unloved, unworthy. It's a fate worse than death. I've been there. I know exactly what it's like. I hated myself for years. Just like my parents did. I just like them. Thank you, Jesus. I pray now for any person that fit my teaching last night when I was talking about the mind and the chronic negative thoughts in the mind about themselves or someone else. I pray right now that you will break that curse off their mind. In Jesus' name, I pray you'll break it off. I pray for every person here who fears their future. What if things don't change? What if it doesn't get any better? What if the money doesn't come in? What if I don't get any help? What if? I pray for every what if person here today. Because all the promises of God in Christ are yes and amen. All of them. All of them. We preach the unsearchable riches of Christ. That's what we preach. That means there's hope for every person that comes for it. There's no hope for people who won't come for it. It's all based on your free will. Now, if you need prayer, now come down and see me down here, and we'll just pray for a little bit, and then you can go home. And I'm going to make sure that you've got this bondage and these spirits off of you. Thank you, Jesus. You open up your heart to the Lord and let your tears go. You just let your tears go right now. The Holy Ghost come right on you just like that. He wants to help you more than you want to be helped. But you must come to Jesus to get that help. The Holy Spirit just doesn't throw it out there like seeds. You got to open your heart. Say, dear God, I made mistakes. I screwed up. I hurt somebody. I hurt myself. Come on out, devil. I hurt myself. Today is my day to receive the healing of my heart. My heart. My heart. You came for Brother Mike, Lord. You can come for me. For God is no respecter of persons. Somebody like Brother Mike, a piece of human garbage, got saved, filled with the Spirit, given a ministry. If God can drag me out of a toilet, Satan come out. If God can drag me out of a toilet, anybody can be healed. Anybody can be healed. God is no respecter of persons. God is no respecter of persons. If you meet the conditions, you get the miracles. Period. Humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, and He will exalt you in due time. Humble yourself in the sight of the Lord, and He will lift you up. You got to humble yourself first. You got to move first. You got to move first. My daughter preached a nasty sermon to me. My daughter preached a filthy sermon. But then it was my responsibility to respond. And I did respond. You got to respond. Come on, devil. You got to respond now. Just pray like King David. Have mercy upon me, Lord, according to thy loving kindness, according to the multitude of thy tender mercies. Blot out my transgressions. Come on now. Just pray like King David tonight. Just pray like King David. The Lord is near those who have a broken heart. And he saves those who have a contrite spirit. Come on now. Pray like King David prayed. Cast me not away from thy presence, O Lord. Take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Have mercy upon me, Lord, according to thy loving kindness, according to the multitude of thy tender mercies. Blot out my transgression. God, save me. Pray like King David tonight. Pray like King David prayed. The Holy Ghost come right to you. He'll come right over to you. Guaranteed. It's guaranteed. It's a guarantee. Humble yourself under the mighty hand of God, and he will exalt you in due time. This is your time. Behold, now. Today is the day of salvation. Now is the accepted time. Open your heart now. Do it now. You got a ministry ahead of you. God's calling you to ministry. He's calling you to help other people. This is your moment. This is your chance. Make your move. Come on now. Open your heart quickly. Quickly open your heart. Lord Jesus. Lord Jesus, help me. Help me, dear Lord. Help me, dear Lord. Pray like Peter. Just pray like Peter. Lord, save me. That's what he said. You don't need a long prayer. Prayer from a heart. Two words gets you a miracle from God. Lord, save me, Peter said. That's how you pray. Pray like Peter. Pray like Peter. Lord, depart from me, for I am a sinful man. Be of good cheer. From now on, you will be a fisher of men, Peter. Because you humbled yourself, because you broke yourself, you will be a fisher of men. You will not be fishing fish anymore. Peter had to break himself. Depart from me, Lord. I am a sinful man. That's how you do it. That's how you do it. God. Romans chapter 8. Likewise, the Spirit helps us with our infirmities. We don't know how to pray as we ought to, but the Spirit himself groans for us. Go ahead. If you can't pray, just groan. Oh,
Lord, help me.
If you can't pray, then just groan. Oh, Lord. Oh, God. The Spirit helps us with our infirmities. We don't know how to pray, but he groans for us. He's groaning for you tonight. He's groaning for you.
Help that guy right there.
He's groaning for you. Come on now. Oh, I don't know how to pray. Yes, you do. You can groan. Oh, God. Oh, God. Oh, Lord. Anybody can groan. Are you kidding me? Anybody can do that. You can groan. Oh, Lord. Oh. Oh. Oh, God. Oh, my God.
I know I've received deliverance. I know it because I felt it. But for some reason, in a lot of ways, it seems like I'm having more anxiety and more pain.
No, no, you're not. That's a blessing. What God's telling you is you had this many demons. Now you got this many. And he's showing you ones that are left. You just described it. What'd you just say?
That's what I said.
What'd you say?
That it feels like it's worse.
Yeah. Who's doing that? They're doing it. Yeah. It's God showing you. He loves you. You had this many, right? And you got now you're here. You're doing great. You obviously have the anointing because these are gone. Yeah. Yeah.
So just keep going.
Yeah. And plus I'm gonna ask God to give you the gift of hate. Father God, the stinking demon in his back, I hate him. And I command him just to come out. Come out. Get out of the back. Come out in Jesus' holy name. You stinking devil. Come out of that stomach. You demon of fear, I command you to come out. He commands you to come out. He hates your guts. Go now. Come out. Get out of that body right now. I command you to come out of my body. I hate your guts. Come out in Jesus' holy name. Right this second, come out. Tell him to come out. Tell him out. Come out of that body right now. Come out of there. How you been?
Pretty good.
Good to see you.
Yeah. We got family here.
Family here?
Yeah.
Oh, where are they? Out in the hall? Yeah, bring them in here. Just pray like King David. Just pray like King David prayed. That's how you pray. Oh God, against thee and thee only have I sinned and done this evil in your sight. Just pray like King David. He just confessed it. Did you hear that? He just confessed it. Oh God. Oh God, help me. Help me, Lord. Against you and only you have I sinned, O Lord, and done this evil in your sight. Just confess your sin, just like that. Oh God, have mercy on me. Dear Jesus, forgive me. God, forgive me. Come on now. Sweet Jesus, forgive me. Help me, Lord. Help me, Lord Jesus. What's wrong with him?
He manifests, he growls.
Oh, no. Nah. He attacks you?
He attacks me. I stay home with him all day.
Oh, you stay with him all day? Come on over here. All right. Come on. Come on over here. There we go. All right, now. There it is right there. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, God. Lift this sadness and sorrow out of your child right now. There it is right there. Come out in Jesus' name. Come out of her. Fear of his future. Fear of surviving. Fear of having no help. Demons wearing me to the bone. Come on out. Come out. Come out of there right now. Come on out. Come out of there in Jesus' name. There it is. Grief and sorrow. Loneliness. Hopelessness. Out you go. There it comes. There it comes. Hold that. Come out of that body right now. Hurry up. Get out of there. Come out right now. Come out right now. Come on, everybody. There, come out right now. Quickly. Quickly come out. Come out right now. Every evil spirit from her mother and father. Come on, everybody, right now. There it is right there. Here he comes. Good. Come on out. Come out. Come on out. Quickly. Come out right now. Quickly. Quickly. Come out right now. Worry and fear. Fear spirits. Come out of her tummy. There it is. There he is. Come out of her. Come on out of there. Come out in Jesus' name. Come out right now. Come out of there right now. Loneliness, fear. Go. You rotten devil, you stole her joy. You stole her joy and replaced it with exhaustion. Come out. Come out. There he comes. Come out, Satan. Go, Satan. There he comes. Thank you, Jesus. Poison, come out. Poison. Poison, come out. Get out of that body right now. There he is. That's him right there. Here he comes. Out. Out. Go. Come on, that body right now. Quickly. You come out of there right this second. Come on out. Hopelessness. Go. Hopelessness. Hopelessness. Out you go. Hopelessness. Get out of that body. Let her go. Let her go. Go. Let her go. All the disappointments of my marriage and my childhood. Go. There it is right there. Come out. There it is. All the disappointments of my childhood. Go. Come out. All the exhaustion, total exhaustion from my son's demons are torturing me. Go. Come on out. Come out. There they go. Good, good. Come on out. Keep coughing. Come out. There it goes. Keep coughing. Come out, devils. Come on out. Quickly. Come out right now. You get out of my body right this second. Every spirit from my husband, come out of my body right now. Go. Go. Every ugly man that ever touched me, come out. Go. Come out of my feet. Come out of my womb. Come out of my genitals. Come out right now, quickly. Come out of here, quickly. There you go. Get out of there, quickly. There it comes. Come on out. Come out of there. Let's go. Leave my body right now. Leave my body right now. Leave my body right now. Go. You come out of there. You come out of there right this second. Every evil spirit in my home, get out of my home. Every evil spirit in my life, I command you, I bind your power. Come out of me. Come out. Disappointments, sadness, loneliness. Go in Jesus' holy name. Go in Jesus' name. There he goes. There we go. Come out right now. Come on out. Come out of there. Leave. I'm not taking any more torture from my son's demons. I'm not taking any more torture. This is it. This is it. Come out of me right now. Every ounce of anxiety. Using food as a comfort. Come out, you food demon. Come out. Instead of the Holy Spirit, my comforter, I use food. I repent of it. I repent. Right now, no more food. Go. No more food. No more. Come out. There it goes. Thank you, Jesus. Here it comes. Come on up. Controller, come out of her. Get out of there. Poison, come out. There we go. Good. Thank you, Jesus. Get out of there. Go. Get out of her throat. Get out of her throat right now. Come on out. Get out of there. Come out of that body right now. In the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Every fear spirit, come out of me right now. Every demon I picked up from my son, go. You're kidding me. I don't even have any hair ties up here. Seriously? Kidding me. What do you mean? You can't. Oh, there we go. Get out of that body right now. Come on now. Go now. Come on. Come on. Come on. You're not done. You're not done. You come out. All of you come out. There they come. Good. Good. Go.
Come out of her. Come out of her, all that pain.
Go.
Come out of her. Come out of her.
Get out of there.
Right now, listen to them. When two or more are together, there you are.
Go.
God is here. Freedom. Freedom in the name of Jesus Christ.
I repent of all these negative thoughts I have all the time about my son. Go right now. Come out of there quickly. Out. Out you go.
Come out of
this. Come on out. How you doing?
I had better days.
Now what's wrong with you?
Like sun is choking me all the time.
Yeah.
I can't sleep.
Yeah. What is that?
I don't know.
When did it start?
Recently.
Oh, just recently?
For a long time, but like if I want to take a nap, that's not going to happen.
Did you used to be on drugs?
No.
No drugs?
I have done them, but never chose drugs over
anything.
It never was like Sunday night, I'm going to go do tomorrow or next week. It was like, okay, I'm going to party this weekend, but I don't need it next week or probably a month or 6 months, you know? So I never was wrapped up on it, but like.
No drugs? Alcohol?
Alcohol.
Porn?
No,
no porn?
But I think it came in.
No, that. Before.
Yeah.
Not now, before.
That's it, but I think,
oh.
I think what happened was, you know, even recently, I told my wife I've been having the urge. Today's been my wife's birthday. And I don't know, I need deliverance. I always feel like something's choking me.
Yeah, that's him.
I wake up in the middle of the night, like,
yeah. Yeah,
and
that's them.
The doctors, there's nothing wrong with me physically.
No, there's nothing wrong with you. He's doing it. Yeah, that demon got in there and I was choking you.
Feel wrapped around me, you know?
Oh, yeah. Close your eyes there. Thank you. What's your name?
Jacory.
Jacory. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, thanks for sending Jacory down here. He's in big trouble right now. He's got demons inside of his body. They're actually trying to kill him at night. They're choking him out. And they're giving him insomnia. They're trying to steal his strength. And then they're going to cut him down after he's so exhausted he can't believe it. Lord, tonight he's going to completely and totally apologize to you for all this evil sin he's been involved in. He lived a horrible past. He did everything. Adultery, porn, lies. Cursing and swearing, living a sinful life. And when he was doing that years ago, he let in a monster. A monster hiding. And he needs to come out now. And he's sorry for his sin, Lord. He's asking you to forgive him. There he is. Come on up. Come up. That's him right there. Come up, you monster. Come out of there, you killer. Come out in Jesus' holy name. He repented of it. He apologized to the Lord for his wickedness. He said he was sorry. That means you got to come out. Come out of that throat. There he is right there. Here he comes. Come on up. Come up. Come up. Here he comes. He's getting ready to come up right now. Hold that. Sarkoff. Come out right now. Here he comes right there. Come up. Come up, Spirit. Come on up, Spirit. There he is. Come out of there. Come out right here. He comes. Come out, devil. That's him right there. Evil, come up. Evil, here it comes. Poison and evil, come up. Evil, come up. Get out of that body right this second. Come out of that body right now. Hurry up. Come out of that body right now. Come out of there, you stinking lust spirit. You lust spirit. You drug demon. Out. Come out of his spine. Go. Get out of that body right now. Come out of his throat. Stop choking him at night. You spirit of fear. Sleep paralysis. I break your power. Pornography. Come out of his eyes. Come out of them eyes. Come out of his eyes. Come out. Get out of that body right now. Hurry up. Come out of there. Porn. Come out. There he is. Keep coming up. Poison. Poison. Go in Jesus' name. Poison. Come out. Come out of there. Come out in the name of the Lord. Insomnia demon. Go. Insomnia. Come out. There he comes. Keep coughing. Come out, devil. Come out of there quickly. Quick, quick, quick. Quick, quick, quick. Quick, quick, quick. Here he comes. There he is. There he comes. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Demonic poison, come out of that body. Demon poison, go. You get out. Come out. Come out of there. Lying. You liar. You fear spirit. Go now. Come out. Come out. Come out of there. Get out of my throat. There he comes. That's him right there. Evil, come out. Evil. Come out. Evil. Evil, come out. Evil, come out. Get out of that body. Hurry up. Come out of there. Satan, I command you to loose your hold of me. Come out of my mind. Come out of my body. Thus saith the Lord. You speak in tongues? There you go. Good. Keep going. Good. Keep going. There it is. Get up. Come out, Satan. Oh, there's more in there. Come on. Out all the, they all come out. Get them out of there. Quickly. 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 There it is. There it comes. There it comes. Thank you, Jesus. There it comes. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Satan, loose your hold of me. I command you, devil. I command you to obey. I command you to obey. I renounce you. I reject you. Sin, evil, wickedness, iniquity, I renounce you. Come out of my body. Come out in Jesus' holy name. Get out of there. Go now. You get out of my throat. Don't you ever choke me again. Don't you ever do it. Go in Jesus' holy name. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. You speak in tongues? Go ahead. Yeah, close your eye. Go ahead. Crank it out. Go. Go. What's going on here?
Release
of peace. Atta girl. That's how you do it. Now, what's wrong with your son? What?
He has like autistic-like things, but he's not diagnosed as autistic. It's more like he growls. He recognizes people. He has eye contact. He calls him. He answers you. But his speech is delayed. But now we notice that he growls and he scratches me.
Yeah, he's getting worse. Yeah, and then what about your husband?
My husband.
What's wrong with him?
He's not abusive to me or him. He's not. He's just he's a little impatient, and he grew up without a father, so I think he has a lot of anger and stuff. And he just, you know, he reads the word in the man of God. He's like, okay, you guys, come on, get with it, get better. You know, he's like impatient. And with Samuel, you know, he prays for him. Commands the spirits to come out, but you know, we're still struggling. And he told me the other day, he said, I'm gonna go and whatever needs to come out of me, I'm hoping. He told me, Lord, fine, I'm hoping.
And he doesn't know what needs to come out, he doesn't know, does he? He doesn't know what needs to come out.
He doesn't. Well, I tell him because I'm his wife, I think he's
raging. He doesn't believe you, huh? Does he believe you?
He says, well, if you think that's what needs to come, I said, honey, you guys.
Well, see, well, he has to know himself. See, what he's saying there is, I'm not sure you're right. I was talking about it earlier. Okay, but you love him, don't you? Yeah, and you're worried about him too. Go ahead and repent. Go. I'm going to turn my husband over to you, Lord, because I can't fix him or heal him. I'm going to release him now out of my heart into your hands. In Jesus' name. Any spirit that transferred into me from his impatience or anger right in here must come out now. Here it comes. There it comes. Hold on now. There it goes. There it goes. Come out. Come on out. Come on out. There it is. Her husband's demons are coming out now. Go now. There you go. Good. There you go. Come on. Let's go. How's it going in here? You have any negative thoughts when you're sitting there? What was it? What thought?
That I was losing.
Yeah, he tells everybody that.
I know.
Yeah. But you're not listening to him anymore. Remember? No, I'm not listening to you anymore. I said no. No, I said. Stop talking to me. Come out. Now go. Go, here it comes. Go. Go. Get out of there. Come out of there, crazy. You crazy spirit, come out of there. You're trying to make her insane. Go. Get out of there. Insanity, go. Get out, insanity. Come out. Insane. Get out of that body right now. Come out. I want my sister's demons out of me. Go. There it goes. Go. Sister, come out. I want my sister out.
That's right, my man.
Out you go. Out. There you go. Come out. Come on out. Come out. Come out there. Come out. Her sister's demons need to come out. Her sister verbally abuses her all the time. Come out of there right now. Come out right now. Get out of the bunny. There it comes. Thank you, Jesus. Good. Out. Spirit, out. All the disappointments for my son and my husband must leave me now. Get out of the body right now. Hurry up. Every demon from my sister, go, I said. Come out. You get out of there. You get out of there. Come out. Come out. I'm releasing this for the rest of my life. I'm not going to lose my joy or my peace ever again. Come out. There it goes. There it goes. Thus saith the Lord. Repent so the times of refreshing will come from the presence of the Lord. Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in Jesus' mighty name. And you will receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Repent and be baptized, every one of you, so the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord. Thus saith the Lord. Paul, it hurts to kick against the pricks. Are you kicking against the pricks? Are you trying to win and be healed in your own strength? Like Paul, kicking against the pricks. Just repent of it. Just repent of it. Just repent of it. And heal. Heal, Lord. Heal her, Lord. Bless her, Lord. Heal her, dear Lord. Bless her, dear Lord. Bless her, Lord. Heal her soul. Heal her soul. Heal her soul, Lord. Heal her soul. Be healed. Remuria Eroro Remushalubi Andora Velola Oribiri Ururia. How you doing? What was coming out there earlier? What was that?
It was a fear.
Fear of what?
Of the future. Walking in the path of the Lord.
Yeah, now people have fear. You know why? Because they don't believe God. That's why they're afraid. They don't believe God. And if he says something, they don't buy it. So the fear is only a symptom of the root problem. See that? All right. Lord Jesus, I repent of not believing your word. I didn't believe what you said, and the demons of fear hit me right here and right here because I don't believe. But I do really believe. And today, I'm going to believe and receive. You are going to take care of me. You will help me. You do care about me. I have nothing to fear. And I command and take authority over every spirit of fear in my body now. I repented of it. Go. Come out. Oh, here he goes. Keep coughing. Come out. Come on out. Come out of her body right now. Get out of her kidneys. Come out of her kidneys. Come out of there right now. Hurry up. Satan, loose your hold of her. Come out right now. Get out of that body. Come out of there, you stinking masturbator. Come out of that body. You get out of that body right now. Satan, I command you to come out. I command you all to come out. Right now, every bit of them. All of them. Hurry up. Oh, hurry up. Come out of there. Quickly. Quicker. Quickly. Quickly. Get out of my tummy. Come out of my vagina right now. Come out of my tummy. Come out of my lungs. There they go. Come out of my lungs. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Go. Go. Get out of my spine. Get out of there. Help all these people. Get out of there, buddy. Come on, buddy. Hurry up. Get out of there right now. Come out of there, you liar. You liar. You liar. Go. Go now. Come out of my spine. Get out of my neck. Come out of my forehead right this second. Out. Get out of that body right now. You come out of my legs right this second. Get out of there. Come out of my feet. Come out. Get out of that body right this second. Come out of there. Come out of them legs. Come out of her head. Go, Satan. You go, Satan. You go, Satan. Get out of that body right now. Hurry up. Hurry. I bind your power. I demand you leave me. I demand you come out. I demand you come out. I demand you come out now. You get out of my body now. Hurry. Hurry. Get out of my body right this second. Satan, I command you to lose your power. Loose me. Loose me. Loose me. I want you out of my body right now. I'm out of my throat. Get out of my sleep. Stop giving me insomnia. Go. Get out of there quickly. Come out quicker. Come out quicker. Thank you, Jesus. Come out quicker. Took you a moment. Come out quicker. Get out of there. Hurry up. Let's go. Let's go. Let's go. Everything. All of it. Everything. All of it. Everything. All of it. You get out of there right now. Go. All of it. All of it. All of it. The dying leper said to Jesus, if you want to, you can make me clean. And Jesus said, I want to. I want to be clean. Lord, if you want to, you can heal my son. And Jesus said, I want to. I want to heal him. If you want to, you could make me clean from leprosy. If you want to, you could heal my son. And Jesus said, I want to be healed. Be clean. Thank you, Jesus. I want to. Three words for you tonight. That's your prophecy. You take it home now. I want to. That's what God said. I want to. I want help. I need to be healed. I need deliverance. I want to. Is God's response. Every single time. I want to. I want to. Heal my family, Lord. Heal us. Heal my family, oh God. Heal my loved ones. Thank you, Jesus. You demon of food, I'm not using you as a comfort ever again. Come out of my body and get out of my leg, you fat. Come out of that body right now. Stop wearing me out with food. Stop it. There he comes. Come out, you food demon. Come out of there, you food demon. Come out right now. I command this weight to come off her body. Come off right now. Fat, come off there. Get off that body. Come out. Get out of there. No more food. No more. No more. You come out of that body right now. Love you. Come out of that body right now. Get out of there. You pig demon, you come out of that body right now. I know what you're trying to do. You're trying to give her diabetes and high blood pressure. You're not going to do it. Stop it and come out. Come out of that body. I know what you're doing. You're trying to give her diabetes. Come out of there, you filthy spirit. Spirit of food, I place a binding power of God upon you. She commands you to come out. Comfort eating, I break that curse over her. Comfort food, I break your curse. Go. Thus saith the Lord, go. You get out of there. You get out of there. You come on out. You get out of there. Come on out. Come on. Go. A lifetime of disappointments. Leave. Leave. Sorrow, misery, sadness, disappointments. Leave me now for the rest of my life. There they come. Thank you, Jesus. There you go. Good. Good. Thank you, Jesus. I'm getting healed today, and my son is next. I believe in miracles. I believe in miracles. That's what Catherine said. She said, I believe in miracles. And because I believe in miracles, I see miracles. That's what she said. I heard her say it. I believe in miracles. Well, guess what, sweetie? We do too. The miracle worker, Jesus of Nazareth. Jesus of Nazareth. The miracle worker. No more disappointments. No more sorrow. No more heartache. no more living in pain and sorrow. This is the end today. No more disappointments. No more disappointments. Get out of there. Come out in Jesus' mighty name. Thank you, Lord. The Holy Ghost is here. That means you can have anything you can believe for. Because He's got it all. Everything. If you can believe for it, you're going to get it. No questions asked. You can have anything today you can believe for. The Holy Ghost is here. The one and only. Jesus said, "This is my body broken for you." Thank you, Lord. This is my body broken for you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, I believe. I have the authority to cast demons out of my son because I'm his mother. And I left my authority out of fear and unbelief, but today I take it back. I have authority to cast demons on my son because he's my son, not the devil's son. The devil doesn't have him. He's mine, and I'm giving him to Jesus. I have the right to give my son to Jesus because he's my son. Thank you, Lord. Now I repent of unbelief and doubt. Right this second. I turn my back on it. Unbelief and doubt. No more. No more. Hey, what's going on with this guy? What's wrong with him?
Well, he's got memory problems, right? Mm-hmm. Memory problems.
Had memory problems.
And then do you speak in something. Tongues?
Yes.
Oh, you do? Speaking what age? Tongues. What age did you start that?
Oh, in my 20s.
In your 20s? Wow. Okay, now, what's wrong with you?
Well, I've got this demon that keeps bugging me, waking me up, and won't let me sleep.
No, that's not the problem, though. What? How do you get in there?
I don't know. I don't know.
When did that start?
It was in Arizona, Prescott Valley.
Okay. What happened?
About 3 years ago, I guess, when it started. I guess.
Okay.
And then I went through a divorce. And then
3 years ago?
Yeah. I moved to Virginia and bought a camper. And then it really got bad in the camper. They started harassing me really bad. I found you on the internet and I started.
But you didn't have that demon before you got divorced.
Yes.
You had it before that? Uh-huh. Okay. Then what was going on just before he got in? Where were you? What were you doing?
Well, I had a relationship with someone on the internet. Email.
Internet romance?
Sort of, but I never...
Never did anything about it, just hit on the internet.
Yeah.
That was before you got divorced?
Yeah.
That was before he got in?
Yeah.
Oh.
As far as I know.
And then how'd that relationship end on the internet?
I told her that it was wrong, that we should not do this, that she should repair her relationship with her husband, and I quit talking to her.
And then what? How did she take it?
Well, she said she was really upset and that I hurt her.
And then, do you happen to know if she had any kind of spiritual background? What religion was she? What church she go to?
I don't know. I don't know about that. I did some research on something about her, and there was some kind of a witchcraft thing. But
what was her name?
Daisy.
Okay, we see that's easy. See that? Daisy hates him. and put a curse on him because he dumped her. Isn't that what he just said? See that? And then all of a sudden he got in. Yeah. Daisy's in there.
Daisy's in
there? Uh-huh.
Yeah.
And he opened the door. He's on the internet with Daisy and didn't know that she had spiritual powers. And so he opened, huh? He what?
Emotional adultery. Without him, like, would he make curse for that?
Yeah, that's what he had, but he was talking to Daisy and didn't realize she had spiritual power. And she got in there. That's Daisy in there. And he opened the door. Come on in.
Yeah, and some of the visions that I see, they're handing me a little flower. I guess it's like a daisy.
Oh, Daisy wants to get back with her. Daisy's demons want to get back together. See that? Give him a flower. It's Daisy. You got to get Daisy out of there. Yeah. Good. You speak in tongues? She does. Stand up. Yeah, okay. Go ahead. Go ahead and sing it out. Ready? Go. Louder. Louder. How you feeling right now? How you feeling right now? Relieved?
I feel like a ton of weight came off regarding my son. Praise God. Everything you said was like exactly what I was going for.
Yeah. Thank you, Jesus.
So grateful. Thank you.
You're healed now, right?
Thank you so much.
Okay. Come on over here.